TVI has unique pictures of the hostages inside the American embassy in Tehran. The student guards refused to let us see their captives, but they did agree to take pictures for TVI and to record their answers to our questions. The strain shows on the faces of the prisoners. That's the hostages' story. Good evening. Still in the balance tonight, the Shah's life against the freedom of 50 American hostages whose mental state and physical condition remain a mystery as the international crisis around them grows. Tonight, TVI has new evidence of what's going on inside the US Embassy. This is part of a message that one of the hostages recorded for this program and for his family.
I just want them to know we're all right now. And we will be that way, you know, until the Shah's returned.
We're going to play you the whole of this unique interview. We'll also be playing it to the American ambassador to the United Nations. What fresh light does he think it throws upon the situation? But first, from Tehran, here's how I find conditions in and around the embassy.
In the name of God, the beneficent, the merciful, the hostages are in our hands, and we protect them strongly. And we are ready so that in the case of any military intervention, we will destroy them.
This week, the battle fleet of the world's most powerful nation neared Iranian waters. But their arrival made little difference outside the US embassy in Tehran, an embassy that is now unrecognizable under layers of revolutionary banners and posters. Once, these buildings were the hub of US power in Iran. Today, they're the scene of America's humiliation. Filmed secretly from a nearby rooftop, the US embassy looks deserted, even tranquil. But inside the silent buildings, the agony of the hostages goes on. Almost around the clock, the embassy's main gate is the scene of a strange carnival, a carnival of hate. From the walls of the embassy, a student leader harangues the crowd below in a meeting that drags on into the night. The crowds never seem to tire of chanting. Their words echo around the walls of the embassy. Long live Khomeini, bring back the Shah, death to Carter. The embassy has become a revolutionary theater, and the world's press are among the principal actors on the stage. Every day, reporters and cameramen assemble at the gates. Thousands of words are written, but facts about the hostages are few. It's become a propaganda war, and from time to time, the students lift the curtain of secrecy just a little to let their message get out. In a small courtyard on the edge of the compound, student leaders meet the press under the watchful eye of armed guards. The reporters want to know how the hostages are being treated. Instead, they get a lecture.
The CIA had various agents as embassy personnel, to each of whom a cover was assigned, so that the true nature of his job would not be exposed.
There are at least 400 students inside the embassy. But even after a month, no one can say who they are or who is really in control. Even at press conferences, the mystery is maintained.
Okay.
You've had him for a month and you haven't asked him?
Yeah, we haven't.
You've had him for a month?
We haven't.
Four weeks and you haven't asked him?
Yeah. We haven't.
The students will only answer questions that have been written down beforehand. Questions about their organization or identity, they just ignore.
We cannot answer any questions about their security measures.
After days of secret negotiation, I was given permission to take a TVI team inside the embassy. Apart from these shots near the gate, we were forbidden to film any general views of the compound. Instead, we were taken to a small room in the heart of the embassy. Answering my questions, a girl who would only be identified as Mary. She told me of her hatred for the United States.
The United States is an imperialist power, and it's one of the characteristics of an imperialist power to plant spy dens and spy networks all over a country to control all its major political, social, economical systems, and to control these systems for its own benefits. So they work for its own profits. They exploited our natural resources. They exploited our oil.
But are you really saying that the people that you have taken prisoner, that you're holding in this building, are responsible for that in a way?
No, we don't say that the people directly. The system, the United States imperialist system, is responsible for this. The hostages here, okay, they were just people handling the thing. We don't say that these hostages are innocent. No, they were the people through which these crimes, many of them, have been done. And yet,
but they're still hostages, aren't they? I mean, they were diplomats, and they're now hostages.
Well, what does that have to...
That is the basis, if you like, of international anger.
That is the basis, but what about the
international
crimes?
That international law has been broken.
What about international law in the case of the crimes that the Shah committed? In the case of 60,000 martyrs we gave in this country? In the case of 100,000 handicapped people we gave in this country? The Shah turned this country into a ruin. And of course, do the American people, do the Western people know this? No. And of course they don't understand then what happens.
They had to come here to get work.
To try and explain their case to us, two of the students from the embassy took us on an expedition to the slums of South Tehran, a symbol for them of the corruption of the Shah's regime and of the economic imperialism practiced by the United States.
They've taken our oil.
In this urban dust bowl live some of the people who missed out on the Shah's dream of a new Iran.
America as... Huh? Not the American people, the American government. They have, so to say, they've licked the blood of these people in order to get their own technology improved. That's it.
You
see, they've taken the oil of this people.
Taken the petrol that Iran produces.
Oil, not only petrol, their mines and other underground resources.
The Islamic Revolution took shape in these streets, and today the people welcome the students from the embassy and listen with approval when they blame the country's woes on the Americans. And are they prepared, are the people here prepared for what might be a confrontation with the American government?
Up to their last breath and up to their last drop of blood.
Even if the Islamic leadership didn't organize the takeover of the US embassy, they are certainly exploiting the revolutionary fervor that it's created. At a mass meeting on the holy day of Ashura, Khomeini's number two, the Ayatollah Beheshti, used the crisis to call for greater support for the policies of the new regime. The war against imperialism has begun, he says, and neither bombs nor bullets will stop the defenders of Islam. Gathered around the Ayatollah like medieval knights around a king, the soldiers of the revolution. The men in white shrouds have already pledged themselves to die if the Americans attack Iran. A holy war against America might seem an unreal idea, but for these men, the decision is already made. Their religion, their revolution, are both based on the idea of martyrdom.
We don't fear such military actions and activities of United States or any other foreign power. Shah has military power in Iran too. Shah had military power in Iran too. Could he use it? When all the people are ready to defend themselves against a foreign military power, such a foreign power has no chance for success in such a country. And it is the position in Iran.
Today, Iran must be the only country in the world with a television program on how to fire an automatic rifle. Every night for half an hour, an arms instructor shows off his skills to an invited studio audience, who apparently want to know how to tackle American commandos in the street. And Khomeini's government is doing nothing to discourage this war fever.
The American, the United States government must find some peaceful solution for this problem. They return Shah to Iran, and all is
forgotten.
Yeah, forgotten.
But what if they don't return the Shah, Dr. Beheshti?
You must ask them.
Well, but surely the question is for you. I mean, you are holding the hostages. The students are holding the hostages. What happens next?
They will remain in Iran, and the Iranian revolution will decide on them in the future. I think the American government couldn't the background of Islamic revolution in Iran in many years, and they continue this misunderstanding in the present time too. And I am afraid that they will pay the price.
You said at the press conference the other day, you said yourself, that if there was an attack on this embassy, that you would destroy the hostages. Could you really do that?
Yes, we mean it.
Could you personally lift up a gun,
yes,
and put it to the head of one of these people and kill him?
Yes, when I have seen a gun being lifted up, an American machine gun being lifted up, and killing my sisters and brothers in the streets. Of course, oppression and tyranny must be destroyed.
What about the question of what is going to happen to the hostages now? I mean, it's been said that there's going to be a trial. Do you want these people to go on trial?
Yes, these people, if the Shah is not returned.
And but he's not going to be returned, is he? Do you really believe that he'll be returned?
Yeah, we believe they should return him.
But that's another question. Do you believe he will be returned?
And they have to. If they don't return him, the trials will start, and the hostages will be tried, and they'll be tried in a Islamic court, and the sentences will be carried out on them, based on Islamic principles.
Are you at all worried that there could be some kind of psychological damage to these people that you're holding, as a result of their captivity?
Psychological damage to
hostages? Yes, that quite simply that some of them might, if you hold them much longer, just go mad.
Why should they? I mean, in our prisons at the time of Savak, tens of thousands of our most brilliant youngsters were kept in the dungeons and tortured. No one cared for their psychological after effects. They were being tortured there, and everyone knows what came to them those years. And they were really the most brilliant and most intelligent of our young people, and the youngest. And so, can you compare that to this?
The confrontation with America has rekindled the Islamic passions that destroyed the Shah. During the holy festival of Ashura, columns of flagellants whip themselves with an enthusiasm that hasn't been seen for years. Perhaps this is what Khomeini and his clergy wanted, for their popularity was just beginning to sag in the face of the mounting economic problems that their revolution has brought about. If this was their aim, some amongst them must now be feeling just a little worried, for they're still on collision course with the world's most powerful nation, and neither Khomeini nor the students show any sign of backing down.
But how much longer can you go on doing this?
We are ready to go on until martyrdom. And we will struggle and fight.
What does it mean, martyrdom? What does it mean?
Martyrdom is a unique philosophy only for Islam. And it means that when man struggles in the way of his goals until the height of being killed in the way of his goals, in the way of God, that's martyrdom. And martyrs are alive in Islam. Martyrs do not die. Martyrs are not destroyed. They always exist.
So the bullets do not really kill?
The bullets do not kill. And that is the message that the people of Iran gave to all oppressed peoples of the world, that bullets do not kill faith, bullets do not kill humanity, bullets cannot kill the rights of the people.
Inside the embassy, we repeatedly asked to see the hostages ourselves. Our requests were flatly refused. The hostages are fine, we were told, but for security reasons there can be no visitors. After several hours of argument and debate, the students finally agreed to take some still pictures of the hostages with a film we provided. They also agreed that we could submit a list of written questions, which they would put to them. Here's the start of that interview, conducted by the girl called Mary.
We can start with your name.
William Gallegos.
And your job here?
I work here at the American Embassy in Tehran. I'm a Marine guard.
And what's the date today?
Today's December 3rd, 1979, I believe.
The pictures we got back from the students show three of the hostages, none of them identified. They're shown doing exercises for which they apparently have 15 minutes a day. In neither the pictures nor the tape recording is there proof of whether the hostages are still in the embassy at all, for there have been reports that they've been moved to other parts of Tehran. What there is in the tape is a clear sign of the strain that the Americans are now under.
What is your physical and mental state after a month in captivity?
Well, I have been here, I guess, a month or so, a couple of days, and my physical state is I'm good shape, you know. I might have lost a couple of pounds here or there, but my mental state is, I guess, would be as good as expected in any situation like this, you know. Kind of on my nerves, but, you know, I guess that's the way it'll be till we're able to go home.
We don't know what circumstances the interview was conducted in, or why the students chose a Marine guard instead of a diplomat to be the spokesman for the hostages. Perhaps predictably, the Marine, William Gallegos, gives the answers that the students would like to hear.
Do you see any way in which your government could solve this crisis?
I think the only way to solve this crisis now is if they do return the Shah, you know, I mean, they want to put him in front of an international court, and I think he'd get a fair trial. And if he is guilty, he's guilty. If he's innocent, he's innocent. I mean, you know, why should he be kept back? I mean, you know, the government should let him be put to trial. I don't know why they're keeping him in, you know. It's really sad why they're, I guess, I don't know, 50, 60 Americans, you know, being held hostage here. And, you know, nothing's been done yet for our release. It's been over a month now. You know, for one man, you know, who's had a lot of people killed and massacred, you know, weren't even armed or anything.
Several of the questions we sent in were changed by the students. Others were left out altogether. One question I'd put on the list asked what the hostages thought about the possibility of being put on trial before an Islamic court. There's no mention of a trial on the tape, which raises the question of how much the hostages are really being told about their situation. At the end of my list of questions, I invited whoever was answering them to make any statement they liked. This is what William Gallegos said.
The people can't sleep, so, you know, I mean, you know, it's natural, I guess, you know, being held hostage, you can't sleep, you don't know what's going on, you want to know what's happening. I want everybody to know, for one thing, I'm not being forced into this message or these questions. You know, we were asked to, we wanted to let the people know what's going on here. I think they should know. I think everyone in America should know, the government, the people, my family especially. The students are really great. They're helping us any way they can. They're really friendly. They try to talk to us. There's a slight communication gap because of the language, but they try. And, you know, the biggest thing is they tell us they have nothing against the people of America, only the government. They're treating us as best they can, you know, to make us comfortable because they said they have nothing against us. All he wants is the Shah returned. It's really amazing. I've never heard of a hostage situation like this before, you know. It's really different than, you know, these aren't terrorists. They're just students. They're young. And it's really amazing how organized they are in keeping us together and giving us a clean place to stay and, you know, everything like this. It's really great. And I think, you know, not only for myself, but everybody here, we have the right to ask the question is why hasn't the Shah been returned? Is he really worth that much to America? What has he done for the people there? You know, he sure didn't do anything for the people here. And I know my family would like to have me in their home, you know, not the Shah.
Ambassador McHenry, you've heard what the Marine Guard, William Gallegos, had to say there in Tehran. What is your reaction to that?
Well, my reaction is the reaction that you would get from anyone who is listening to someone who's been held hostage for 30-some days, it doesn't have very much credibility. Even if it were true, one would question its credibility under the circumstances. If the people of Iran or the people who are holding them hostage really want us to hear them, why don't they let in outside people to talk with them? Why don't they let in international observers? And why do they have to hold them so long?
There seems at least to be no softening of position on the part of the students. Do you believe that America now has any options open to it that could hopefully secure their release?
Well, of course, we're not talking about the students. Unlike any hostage situation that we have seen in the past, there is the government which is involved here. And if it were just the actions of the students and the government actively working towards their release, it would be a different situation. But the world is familiar with the statements which have been made by government officials involved here.
Your aircraft carriers, the Kitty Hawk and the Medway, have arrived near Iranian waters, yet there seems to be no impact felt in the streets of Tehran at all. There does seem to be no softening of position on the part of the government, or at least none that one can detect. What do you feel is the next move in this crisis?
Well, I'm not sure that the aircraft carriers were particularly and specifically intended in the current situation to affect. They put the United States in a position where it can react if the circumstances should so demand. What we are currently doing, and what we've been doing all along, has been to pursue the peaceful diplomatic options which are present here. After all, our intention has to be to get the safe release of the hostages. We're exploring every channel that we can.
But after a United Nations resolution calling for the release of those hostages and little discernible response from Tehran, what do you feel that President Carter, and indeed yourself, can now do to set at rest the fears of the American people?
Well, I'm not sure that I would agree with the assumption of your question, little discernible response from Tehran. Nor would I agree that one has to reach a conclusion on their response at such an early date. The response from Tehran probably indicates a healthy debate which is going on. On the one hand, some of the students have reacted negatively. On the other hand, government officials who had, before the consul acted, dismissed the consul action in advance, have acted in a pretty moderate way. So I think it's too early for us to reach any conclusion. I think we ought to continue to pursue the good offices of the Secretary General. He is pursuing those contacts with the Iranian government, and we will have to see what developments grow from that.
It's been hinted that the U.S. government might be prepared to support some kind of UN inquiry into the past activities and possible misdeeds of the Shah. Is that indeed the case, and do you see this as some way of getting off the hook?
Well, the suggestion has been made that some kind of international inquiry be established for investigating the Iranian grievances. And in principle, we have no objection to that kind of thing. I doubt whether the Security Council would itself agree to establishing such a mechanism. And certainly, there can be no connection between the holding of diplomatic hostages and the pursuit of Iranian grievances. We cannot have it as a precondition.
How much longer do you believe that the American public is prepared to wait?
Well, I've never seen anything resolved by impatience. We are pursuing those avenues which are available to us. Again, I think the important thing is the safe release of the hostages, and we will simply have to continue to pursue every avenue which is available to us.
Ambassador McHenry, thank you very much indeed. The U.S. Ambassador at the United Nations. Tonight, the hostages are spending their 33rd night in captivity. They and the American public are still wondering just how much longer this ordeal can go on. From TVI, good night.
I just want my family to know, and all my friends, especially my mom and dad who are dearest to me, I want them to know. They get this message and want to know I love and miss them very much, and I hope it's not too long from now to return home safely. I just want them to know we're all right now, and we will be that way. You know, and till the Shah's returned.